Okay, a new start. Now I'm not muted and you can see my video. Today we want to start with our second webinar. Many of you have already participated in last week's webinar when we spoke about the Energy Charter Treaty and the possible ISDS claim of Uniper against the Netherlands. Today we want to focus on the German coal phase out and especially on the plant Datteln 4. We have again a high number of participants, which shows us that it's important to speak about these topics in these days. We are happy to have Fabian Hübner from the German Climate Alliance and Thomas Krämer-Kemper from Friends of the Earth North Rhine-Westphalia with us today. They will guide us through the German coal phase-out law or the discussions about it. And Thomas will give you an insight about the current situation regarding Datteln 4. We are completely aware that we will not be able to cover all the aspects around the German coal phase-out law. It's an ongoing discussion for at least a year after the German Coal Commission's recommendations, but the general discussion lasts even longer. And I think we will still discuss coal or the coal phase-out for a longer time in Germany. The same with Datteln 4, a project that started many years ago and it's still very controversial. These webinars, or this webinar also, is designed to share special knowledge, but also to give like a general introduction into the topics. We are aware that also many activists have registered, but this is, as I already said last week, this is not the room for a concrete discussion about actions. It's more for knowledge sharing. But however, we're glad if you want to join us in our struggle. So whenever you decide, okay, what I've heard has motivated me to take action, then you can write an email to me, to sebastian@urgewalt.org, and I can also share your emails with the other speakers if you have very particular questions to them. It's the second webinar, as I said. The first one can be found, at least the presentations can be found on www.urgewalt.org/webinars. Today's the second one. Next week we'll have a break because we'll also be with a delegation in Helsinki to speak to politicians, investors, etc. And then we will continue on the 19th of February with the third webinar on Uniper's gas infrastructure strategy. And we'll have a special look at the planned liquid natural gas terminal in Wilhelmshaven. The final webinar of the series of four will be on March 4th, when we have a closer look at Fortum's and Uniper's dirty coal imports from Russia and Colombia, which is also a very important detail connected to Datteln 4, because as it is a hard coal-fired power plant and Germany stopped sourcing coal on its own, all the coal which will be fired in Datteln comes from abroad, mainly from Russia and Colombia. I think that's it for the moment. We will check if we will set up further webinars if you want to get more in-depth information. And today we'd like to start with Fabian, who can shortly present himself, and then we'll give you an update on the current situation with the German coal phase-out law. Hi, Fabian, and the floor is yours.
Yes, wait, I'm just trying to share my screen. yes, I'm Fabian from Fabian Hübner from the Climate Alliance Germany, of policy officer for coal and energy policy. I've worked for the Climate Alliance since July 2017, and in this capacity followed the Coal Commission and the whole developments around the coal exit law very closely, and worked on mobilizing the protests on coal in Germany. So I like to give you a brief introduction on the coal phase-out law. Wait, I need to start. Yeah. So, just a quick analysis of why this whole policy process of phasing out coal in Germany started. So, well, it's no news that German climate policy does not tackle the climate crisis at all. And after a long time, after I would say more than 10 years, in 2018 with the Hambacher Forest, the protests against coal came into the center of public attention. Germany is missing its 2020 climate target of 20% by at least 5 points, and also needs to meet the legally binding climate target 2030 for the energy sector. And I guess one of the most important points for the government, or for the political system at least, was that neither the expansion of renewable electricity nor the ETS had an effect of the steady share of 40% of coal in the electricity mix until end of 2018. So that's why the government convened the Coal Commission, a commission consisting of 32 members with many stakeholders from different sectors, like environmental NGOs, associations of the energy of energy industry, scientists, people affected by mining, representatives of people affected by mining, and this was a very difficult process until this commission of 32 stakeholders came to an agreement and reached recommendations to the German government. Just in general, these recommendations have never been a societal consensus, but were always regarded, at least from the environmental side, as a minimum trade-off, which NGOs could agree to start the coal phase-out. The compromise in itself included, and that was the most important point, firstly, a start of the coal phase-out, and secondly, a steady coal reduction path from 42 gigawatts online to 30 gigawatts online in 2022 and 17 gigawatts in 2030, with the coal exit date in 2038. Already at that point, environmental NGOs had called for their exceptional vote, not agreeing to the end date 2038 and to the path until of coal reduction until 2030, which lacked any climate ambition in their view. The general idea of reaching a compromise was that coal power plants would be shut down in return for public money as compensation. And a very important aspect of these recommendations, of this compromise, was that no new coal power plant was to go online, and that the German government was recommended to seek negotiations with Uniper for Datteln 4. So here you see a picture of one of the big demonstrations during the coal commission. It was in December 2018, when in Cologne there were 20,000 people on the street, and in Berlin 17,000. So these were the times still before Fridays for Future. At that time, a lot of people, but well, now we count demonstrations in higher numbers, I would say. So after the German government, after mingling with the coal industry for almost 1 year, last Wednesday, adopted the coal exit draft law. The first criticism about this is that the coal commission and this whole process took so long that neither in 2018 nor 2019 any coal power plants were shut down. Well, the milestones the coal commission set, so 30 gigawatt in 2022 and 17 gigawatt in 2030, are met in the reduction path foreseen by the draft law, but always at the latest possible date, which is a big problem because it basically overblows the emission budget underlying the compromise of the coal commission. So how much it overblows the emission budget depends on lots of details, and we haven't calculated all yet, but at least with the reduction path of lignite power plants, we already can say that at least that the reduction path agreed with between the government and the lignite utilities at least overblows the emission budget by 180 million tons. So, but I'm not here to talk that much about lignite, but more about hard coal and what the draft law signifies for the hard coal sector. So in the law, there are auctions for compensations of coal power plant shutdowns foreseen. These are for 2021. There are two auctions foreseen of 4 gigawatt and 1.5 gigawatt. And then until 2033, the government agency will determine the quantity of how much gigawatt are put out for auctions. Auctions the shutdown of coal power plants is being compensated until 2027. And after 2027, there will only be mandatory shutdowns by the German government. If these auctions are underwritten and not enough coal power plants are offered to be shut down to meet the quantity, the government can demand regulatory shutdowns from 2024 on. This reduction path results in hard coal power plants being squeezed out of the electricity system in 2033. Because of the lignite reduction path, which stays online up until 2038. So here you see just a graph of the reduction. You see the points in 2022 and 2030, which were agreed, and 2038, which were agreed by the Coal Commission. And in between, it's the mix of lignite and hard coal power plants being shut down. So, from our side, we find the implementation of the coal compromise basically scandalous. There has been a press conference by 8 former members of the Coal Commission, including one of the presidents of the Coal Commission, declaring that this draft law means that the German government violates the compromise. There are many problems, but I just want to shed a light on a few. So this coal exit law needs to be adopted by Parliament until May 2020. Otherwise, in 2020, there will be no shutdowns again, like in 2019 and 2018. As I said, the allowed operation of Datteln 4 in 2020 in times of climate crisis and a German coal exit sends a scandalous international signal to emerging countries. The emission budget is overrun completely. It was one of the flaws of the compromise that the reduction path was always measured in gigawatt, so in quantity of coal power plants and not in CO2 emissions. But also what makes this coal exit law very uncertain, also for industry, is that the forthcoming increase of the EU climate targets is going to change the coal power plant reduction path in Germany very, very probable. So in the end, this whole coal exit 2038 has always been, in a way, an illusion. And even the German Association of Industry, in internal debates, acknowledges that 2038, no power plant will be online anymore. So just a few points on Uniper and the coal exit, or how Uniper is also affected by the coal exit. Firstly, as many of you know, the 1.5 degrees climate promise of the Paris Agreement requires utilities to phase out coal until the end of 2030. So this is a responsibility of every single utility to avoid the climate crisis. And Uniper should not depend on the unreliable policy measures of the German government, but commit to a Paris compliant coal phase out path. With Datteln 4, it's not only a scandalous signal for the international sphere, but also breaks the call of the UN General Secretary for no new coal power plants in 2020, which he made last year in New York. So for the German climate movement, it is clear that Datteln 4 is going to be the next iconic fight after Hambacher Forest. And as you've seen last weekend with the blockade of Datteln 4 by Ende Gelände, or the week before with the protests of Fridays for Future, many actors are gearing up to protest against Datteln, and this will continue for sure. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Fabian. I haven't seen any direct questions in the chat box, so I would say let's jump from Berlin to west, to the west of the country, and directly hand over to Thomas so that he can share his knowledge about Datteln 4 with us.
Yeah, thank you very much, Sebastian. I hope you can hear me.
Yes, we can.
Okay, that's fine.
We can also see you for the moment.
It's very good. And it's in the rest of the country, exactly, it is in Castrop-Rauxel, actually. Very nice town in the Ruhr area. I will share first my desktop with you. Okay. So I hope you can see the presentation.
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, that's quite good. So I would like to concentrate more on the details of Datteln 4 and the implications of the coal exit or the so far planned coal exit in Germany, and what will happen in reality if Datteln 4 goes to a productive operation mode. And in our point of view, it's a climate killer and the last illicit construction in Europe. And I will like to share our insights into the project. My name is Thomas Kammerkemper. I'm a project leader for Datteln 4 for the BUND Germany since 2006 now, so quite a long time. And I'm also project leader at the BUND for the projects and the actions against the Hambach. So I'm involved in both sites, hard coal and lignite. So let me start with the CO2 emissions, with the greenhouse emissions from Datteln 4, and why exactly it is such a big problem for the future emissions of greenhouse gases. And that is not only because it's a new power plant, huge power plant. In fact, it's the largest one in the world with over 1 gigawatt of net power output. But it is also a power plant that is connected with quite old contracts. And it's mainly the combination of the power plant and also the contracts as a problem. To show you why, I think I can just go over this one because Fabian already told you about the exit paths. I would like to show you this graph with and I would like to give you some explanations about it because it's a little bit complicated, but it shows in principle not only what everyone is looking at Germany on, that's not the difference between what the Coal Commission has proposed and that what the government is going to implement actually, but it's more about the difference between the reality and what the government wanted to implement, because we already have a gap between reality and what's Coal Commission proposal. So here on the left side, the blue line with the big blue circles is the real development of energy output in Germany from hard coal in terawatt hours. So that's real energy output. That is what all the power plants really have produced in this time. And you can see that not only in 2018 with the development of the ETS allowances and the rising price in the system, we already had a very steep decline of the power output of hard coal-fired power plants in Germany in the years before. So since 2015, we reduce the hard coal fired power plants power output by more than 50%. And if you just print a trend line into this graph, you can easily see that this line directs to the bottom line, to the zero line of the diagram in 2021. I'm not going to convince you that we will get rid of all hard coal fired power plants in 2021, because this development will flatten out in the next years, and it will come to a more slowly, to not so steep path that is going in a more flattened way to the zero line. But I think it's quite possible and even probable that we will reach the zero line or almost the zero line in 2023 or 2024. Least we will only have remaining power plants in that area that have very long-reaching contacts or that have a special role in the network, that is, they are responsible for net stability in their local region and they cannot be replaced by other power plants in other parts of Germany. So therefore, we have some residual power plants there after the first years in the 20s. But not very much. The other line in this diagram, the red one, shows the installed capacity of power plants. That is not the power, not the energy output, but the installed power in terawatts that is available in Germany or was available in Germany until 2019. There you see there's only a small decline in the installed power. They produce less and less and less, but the installed basis remains almost the same in the same time. I think it's a fair assumption that all of the energy producers are just waiting for the coal exit law to take part in the auctions and to sell their old power plants that are idle actually, and they get at least some money back for the old power plants. The green line is the prolongation of this installed power with the coal exit proposal of the government, with the actual one in the legal draft. So you see that there's a large discrepancy between what the government plans is the sign of installed power and what the real energy production at least indicates would be the most probable development in the near future. And I should also mention that it is not only a question of old power plants going from the net, but we also have in Germany already 9 new and modern hard coal-fired power plants, which are at the level of Datteln 4. And they are already producing energy since several years now. And in 2019, even they had to reduce their production by over 700 megawatts. So the market already plays against the new power plants. And that gives you a good idea that four will not replace old power plants, but it's already a fight against other new ones. And more probably it's a fight against gas and renewable energies. A slightly different presentation of parts of the same numbers. Again, on the left, in the blue line, you see the development of the real energy output from hard coal in Germany. And the dotted line is a trend line for that. And the yellow circles and the red line is what Datteln 4 would add to this development. The main problem with Datteln 4 is that we have three old tracks, RWE and the Deutsche Bahn, the German railway, that almost guarantees Uniper that they will sell 863 megawatts over the years until Datteln 4 is finally shut down by the government. And that even does not depend if the sun shines and the wind blows and we have enough renewables, even if we would have 100% renewables in work, still then, due to these old contracts, you have a high probability that Datteln 4 will produce energy, unwanted energy, with hard coal. That's simply due to the structure of these contracts. RWE and Deutsche Bahn are paying all the costs for this power plant. And if they get energy from the power plant, they only have to pay the additional amount for the operating consumables, that is the coal and the water and supplies like that. And that is not possible even for renewables to compete with these prices. And it is also not possible for renewables to compete in the network, because this principle of priority for renewables in the network is not valid for the network of the German railway, for the Deutsche Bahn network. And it is also in only minor cases applicable to the other network connection from Datteln 4 that goes directly to a distribution network in the Ruhr area. And there they have also high properties that have to compete with renewable energy and pressed out of the network with renewable energies. So it's mainly due to this combination with the contracts that we will have a high baseline of greenhouse gas emissions from hard coal power plants. And this will prolong the development of the coal-based energy production for, you can see it, it's almost 10, 12 years or something like that. In this picture, I show, in addition, on the left side, the actual production. That's the lower error for that part of the energy production that is produced actually with new coal-fired power plants without Datteln 4. So that's already this installed base of 9 power plants. And the upper arrow shows you what is possible to produce with these new coal-fired power plants. So the real output is already in that area that is dominated by modern coal-fired power plants. And gives you a good a picture for the real competition in which Datteln 4 plays. It's not the old power plants, but it's the new ones, and it is other forms of energy production. So at least from the first early 20s, let's say 2023 or 2025, something like that, Datteln 4 will only compete with the renewables and with gas. And that yields to a surplus of greenhouse emissions from 2 to 6 million tons per year.
Thomas, if I can very briefly interrupt you, I think your connection might be a bit patchy, so maybe it would help if you could turn off your video while you're presenting, because we can see your screen anyway, so maybe that will make the sound a bit better.
Okay, I will try.
Thank you.
So, I got a message that connection is unstable. Okay, should be off now. Can you still hear me?
Yes, and I think it already sounds better.
Okay. So, regarding the question of additional greenhouse gas emissions, most of you know that the German government in the past months denied at first the additional greenhouse gas effects, but actually they confessed that the effect really exists, but they calculated as just 10 million tons in total over the whole period, and that is an order of magnitude less than what we calculate. And the reason for this large difference is that the government assumes a daily market with day-to-day trading of electrical energy. Thus, they are completely ignoring the fact of the various long-term contracts that most of these older power plants still have, and that will also be introduced by Datteln 4 with the new contracts, and the local grid effects that also prevent some older factories to go out of the net. So with a more sophisticated model from the BUND, we get a much higher total sum of additional emissions, and you really have to take this 2 to 6 million tons per year and multiply it by the number of years where you accept that we have only a competition with renewables and gas. And that means, let's say, a period of 10 years or so. Okay, that's about the greenhouse gas emissions. I would like to go in the second part to the legal history and current situation of the power plant. Here's a short overview of what happened with Datteln 4 since this very long time, when in 2005 the project becomes first public for us. And then in 2006, you had a lot of public discussions about the power plant, that it makes no sense, that you will have problems with the steel, that you will have problems with the greenhouse gas emissions, that it is not in line with the plans to reduce fossil energy production and so on. But finally, in 2007, the authorities issued decided about the new development plans, permits, and they also start the construction of the power plant in early 2007. And the BUND then decides to file the first lawsuits against Datteln 4. That yielded to a first shutdown of the construction site, even in 2007. And that was only resolved temporarily by the company E.ON at that point. It was still not Uniper then. And E.ON in that time says that they give a commitment to deconstruct the power plant if they would have a final failure in the fights in the courts. So then they could again restart the construction of the power plant. And in 2009, then we have a very great first court decision that cancels the development plan of the city of Datteln, which is the base of all of the further permits for the power plan. And in the following years until 2012, we have further court decisions that cancel most of the emissions and permits, most of the permits for this power plant. And then in 2014, the authorities start to build new development plans and to make new permits for the power plant. And they also tried to change the law to get Datteln 4 into operation mode. So let me try to show you in a problem to change the view here. Okay. Let me try to show you the cascade of permits that is necessary for this power plant. It starts with the development plan on the country level, then it has a regional development plan, a development plan of the city of Datteln, a land use plan for Datteln, and then the final permissions for the construction of the power plant. And they have, in addition, some partial permissions that they need until they finally, with the sixth or seventh partial permission, they would have been allowed to go to the net. And they also have additional permissions for the construction of a channel harbor to get the coal to the power plant and to discharge the wastewater into a neighboring protected area. That was the situation until mid-2009. And then we had this series of successes with the Kurds. And after that, it looks like this. Most of these levels were killed by the Kurds. So all of these changes of development plans and so on were canceled, and the permissions were either canceled or were illicit, and they were not allowed to use them furthermore. And we have a construction stop for most part of the power plant. But immediately after these court decisions, the government and local politicians start to try to heal the situation and desperately try to bring this power plant to the grid. They never talked about climate protection, reducing the greenhouse gases and so on. They only have the single aim to get this single power plant to the network. And that means that they have some exception permits from the development plan. They made a new development plan for Datteln. They made a new land use plan for Datteln. And finally, the company Uniper gets a new emission control and construction permit to build this power plant and finalize it. But still, we and others are fighting all these levels of permits. And especially BUND sued the lower three levels of permits, and the exception permits are also sued by the city of Waltrop, the neighboring city, that have a lot of consequences due to the operating of Datteln 4, and therefore they decided to also go to court with a fight against this power plant. So what we expect for the next years in 2020 and 2021, we expect that we will have some judicial review of the new land use plan. We also think that we will have a trial of the new emission and building permits that are the main cases that occurred. And I think we have quite good chances to win at least one of this. And I should mention that it is important for Uniper that they win every single of these trials, because if they lose one, they will have no chance to operate the power plant, and they will have no chance to get new permits. So they have to win every one, and we have to sing just a single one. So the chances are definitely on our side. And these red ones are already won once by the BUND, so we are pretty confident that we have some really nice chances to be successful here. So what was, this was too quick, what was the reasons for the court decisions in the past? One of the most obvious reasons is that the distance of the power plant to residential areas is much too small. It should have been 2,500 meters. In detail, it should have been in a completely different place. That was decided by SOET in earlier years that a new power plant should have been only erected in an area that is some kilometers away from Datteln. But they decided to neglect this, and they built the power plant in only 400 meter distance. And that is a big problem also with security concerns for the residentials. Maybe some of you know that there are these famous Seveso directives of the European Union that try to separate industrial usage and residential usage, because you would like to keep all dangerous forms of land use far away from the residentials to minimize the effects. And you also have significant effects on protected areas, the so-called special areas of conservation of the European Union. Here in this case, we have two ones, the area Lippe-Aue, which is close to the River Lippe, surrounding the River Lippe. And we have a big forest, the Kappenberger Wälder, which has actually already a level of acidifying, nutrifying depositions from industrial usage that are much higher than it is allowed. And Datteln 4 will even add acidifying and nutrifying substances to these specific areas of conservations. And that is simply not allowed due to European law. And that is one of the main aspects of our trials in that court. And another example is that Datteln 4 will discharge the wastewater in the River Lippe in this special area of conservation. And this wastewater contains a lot of mercury. And that is even in a situation when the fish, even before Datteln 4 goes to operation, contain already 10 to 25 times more mercury than they should. And we have many, many, many more points that were successful in the past. So I think it's impossible for Uniper to come over all of these problems. And finally, we will have a good chance to win at court. But we would prefer a political solution for this power plant, because it takes a lot of time and at least 2 to 3 years until we even have a chance to have a success at court, because these trials are very complex. But so far, BUND has won all court cases against E.ON and Uniper. And I think I really have mentioned it often enough now. We are really confident that we have good chances for the future. Here's the picture with some more detail why the distance is a problem that is unresolvable for Uniper. You see marked with D4, the location of the cooling tower of Datteln 4, of the power plant Datteln 4, in this land use area from the city of Datteln. And on the right side, you see another cooling tower, which is the formerly planned power plant Datteln 5. So E.ON in the first years even planned to have a second power plant on this location. And due to the fact that they give up these plans only in the late phase of the permission process of Datteln 4, they try to keep the area for Datteln 5 clean of installations. And that yields to the effect that they locate Datteln 4 so close to the residential areas that they really minimize the distance to the residential areas instead of maximizing it. And since they do not longer plan to implement Datteln 5, they according to German law, they had the obligation to move the location of the power plant that turned four that they are really going to build as far away from the residential areas, even inside of this area that you can see here in the picture. So they really walked in a trap that they built by themselves. And since they cannot plan or cannot set the Datteln 4 power plant on tracks and move it away from this position, it's really not possible for them to solve this situation. Next picture shows the gas plume or the deposition of the gas plume of Datteln 4. The map shows the area around Datteln 4, this vast area here. Here in the south, you can see the Ruhr area with all of these cities. Here is Dortmund, this area. And here is the position of the power plant Datteln 4. And the plume deposits most of the acidifying substances close to the power plant, but you also have a vast area which gets even a fairly high deposition from acidifying substances. We are already 15 or 20 kilometers away from the power plant, so it's really a vast area. And here in the dark green, you can see the River Lippe with a special area of conservation Lippeauer. And these yellow spots here are the area of the Kappenberg forest that is already acidified by substances from other plants, not only power plants, but mainly power plants. And they will get additional acidifying substances from Datteln 4 because they are directly in the main wind direction from Datteln 4. And that was one of the main points which we were successful in 2012 to the emission permit for Datteln 4. And it's still the same situation today because the forest had not walked away and the river is still there. Then there are some additional legal risks from third parties, mainly the customers RWE and Deutsche Bahn, required price adaptations in the contracts due to the delays of the project, and RWE has already quitted the contract, but Uniper filed a lawsuit against this quotation, and that is still a discussion that occurred, and we will see what the final outcome would be. But if Uniper loses one of these contracts, I guess it's also a death blow for the power plant. And I've already talked about the lawsuits from the city of Waltrop, and we have some civil plaintiffs that also filed lawsuits against the power plants. So it's really in legal jeopardy, and I'm very curious what the final outcome would be. A short summary. We believe that the introduction of Datteln 4 and it contracts into the market yields to a surplus of 2 to 6 million tons of greenhouse gas emissions per year. And that is in full contradiction of the Finnish and German coal exit plans. We have a manifold of legal actions that are filed against Datteln 4. And since several of them were already successful in the past, and we think that the wrong location of the power plant cannot be healed by any means, that we will be successful also in the future. Uniper also faces large economic risks due to the actions against the old contracts. And the Finnish and German governments would face years of upcoming protests and lawsuits, and both risk further heavy damage of their reputation. And in the case of final defeat incurred, Uniper will also have the situation that they will not get even the slightest piece of compensation. Then they will lose the power plant without any compensation. So that's all from my side, and I will give back to Sebastian.
Thank you very much, Thomas. I think in the second part, the connection was a lot better, but it definitely showed that we do not only have to discuss coal phase out in Germany, but also how to improve the internet connections if we get outside of the big city centers. I would quickly continue and show the connection. If you, Thomas, could stop your screen share, then I can show something different.
And if you should have any other questions for Thomas, feel free to just add them to the chat and we can cover all of those after Sebastian is done with his presentation.
Yeah, I will do it quite quickly, but as we always call these webinars, like webinars on Unicorn Fortum, just want to quickly give you some more insight why we mentioned these two companies. Because who in the end is responsible? We have heard E.ON and Uniper quite a lot of times. So the power plant was originally built and planned by the German company E.ON, which then decided to split off the fossil assets, so the coal power plants and the gas power plants and the water power plants as well, but mainly it's gas and coal. And E.ON at the beginning in 2016 kept 40 or around 47% of the shares of Uniper, but always told that they want to sell these assets in the future. To whom did they sell it? So in 2018, the Finnish state-owned energy company Fortum decided, okay, we could buy these shares from E.ON, and they bought these 47%. And they bought even more, so that right now they own 49.99% of the Uniper shares. There are some legal restrictions still, so they cannot take over the majority, but it seems as if in the first quarter of 2020, this problem should be solved, and Uniper and Fortum will then take over an additional approximately 20 to 23% of the Uniper shares from the investors Knight, Finke and Elliott. So they are already the biggest, by far biggest shareholder of Uniper, and they will become the majority shareholder quite soon. So this is why we say Fortum is here responsible. They are in the driving seat. But as I mentioned before, Fortum is a state-owned company, and 50.76% of the Fortum shares were owned by the Finnish government, especially, or in concrete, the Prime Minister's office. So it's the Finnish government which in the end is directly responsible for what Fortum is doing, or at least they can strongly influence what they're doing. If you have a look at the website of the Finnish government, you will find Fortum amongst the strategic interest companies. So they have a strategic interest. It's not just commercial. They want to get the dividends and that's it. No, it's a strategic interest, so they should act accordingly. The responsible minister for the ownership steering of the state-owned companies is Titti Tuppurainen from the Social Democratic Party in Finland. So if you have open questions after this seminar, why not ask them directly to her or to the other people mentioned here. The prime minister, the current prime minister, is Sanna Marin from the Social Democratic Party. It's a five-party coalition. Katri Kulmuni, the Minister of Finance, is the head of the Center Party of Finland. Anna-Maja Henriksson is the Minister of Justice and the head of the Swedish People's Party. And there are two more. One is the Minister of Interior, who's Maria Ohisalo, the head of the Greens in Finland. And last but not least, Li Andersson, the party leader of the Left Alliance. She's the Minister of Education. So this is the government which is responsible for Fortum at the moment. And I think we should have a closer look at the current position of this government, because the Prime Minister has said in her speech that climate change is the greatest challenge of our future. We must do more to fight against it and faster. This concerns Finland, Europe, and the whole world. I have some It is about the future of our children. This fact has been duly recognized in the government program. We are committed to a carbon neutral Finland by 2035. And our aim is highly ambitious, but it is also indispensable both for us and first and foremost for the future generations. And we want the Finnish government to not only talk the talk, but only to walk the talk and do the necessary action. I've seen we have already some questions in the chat box. That's it from my side. And I would hand over to JC for the questions.